Welcome to the Tony Awesome Fishing Show. Now, most fishermen at some stage in their life will have either seen, used, heard, or even caught fish on lures. That's an artificial lure. It looks like a real fish, except it's made of wood, plastic, or whatever. I'm going to go down to deepest Somerset, which is in sort of mid-south England, to a gentleman that actually makes them handcrafted individually from just a piece of wood. It's quite an insight and quite an eye-opener into how, well, a skill level I don't possess for sure. They're brilliant, they're perfect, they catch fish. Let's get down there. I hope you enjoy it.
Hi, I'm James from Somerset, and I make custom lures for freshwater and saltwater fishing. Lures that go all over the world, different sorts of fish, pelagics, tuna, giant trevellies, and then here in Britain for pike and bass. And today Graham's here and I'm going to show him how I make that, a bit of wood, into something like that. Right, just a little bit about the lures. Here in Britain people tend to use a lot of lipped lures, crankbaits. You just wind them back and retrieve them. But most of the lures I make are what are called stick baits or wobbling lures. And the stick baits are sinking. As you can see, they've got a lot of lead in them, but it means that they're just slow sinking through the water, and it means you can get down to the fish without having to retrieve the lure very fast. So particularly at the moment in the winter, if you were fishing for pike and you want that lure to stay in their window so that they'll hit it, you can fish a slow sinking stick bait very slowly past his face, and it gives him that greater opportunity to take it rather than a crankbait that you'd have to wind fast to get it to go down to him, and it would go scooting past him, and he might look at it, or she, hopefully the big she, but not take it. And this is the advantage of the stick bait that we don't use very much. We haven't really discovered them properly in this country, so I'm trying to introduce them to people here, as well as obviously they are a lot that go abroad, well, where people all know all about them already. Okay, I also do poppers and walk the dog lures for the surface, like that. It's a nice little pike lure, a slightly different body pattern there. And a friend of mine, he had a 15 pounder on one like that. It was his very first pike, Jammy so and so, and that's great fun when you get them up and they just come up and engulf little popper like that. Okay, so the wood that I use, this is just common and garden Douglas fir, which is just the right sort of consistency of weight, a fine enough grain that you can work it on a smaller lure, but it's nice and easy and yet nice and light and yet robust enough to stand up to a bit of punishment. I also use a bit of sapele for heavy work, which is a denser, harder wood. And then they're hand shaped, and I do a bit of gill and mouth parts and countersink the eyes, my eye sockets for them, which is all done in my workshop outside. I also make some smaller ones. These are perch lures, but I tend to do these just for my own use. And that's again just made with the Douglas fir. It's how small you can get, even with Douglas fir. Though I also use balsa wood, this bigger one, pike lure. That's a subsurface wobbler, it's a floating lure, and that's actually made with a balsa base. And I can then take you out and show you the workshop and how it's done. So this is where most of the time is spent on the lures, is making the bodies. That's what really takes the time. And I'll just do a little workshop here with everything laid out. So I've got the bandsaw, and I cut out the basic shape of the lure out of the wood. And then I work it further on the belt sander to smooth it all off and get the shape I want, the rough shape. And then I use a little Dremel with a little block sander there, a little drum sander, busy away, and that gets me the finer shape. And of course, right at the end, I use my hands. And then for drilling the lead in these stick baits, which is a very important thing, in that the whole action of the lure comes from the balance between the buoyancy, natural buoyancy of the wood, and the amount of lead that you put in the belly of the lure, and also exactly where it's placed. And the whole action of the lure comes from that knowledge of how to place the lead and how much and where to put it. And to get those holes, that's done just on a pillar drill like that, where I can just drill those holes nice and accurately to get the lead in where I want. So all I do is I've got my little templates, and then I just draw the outline on the blank, like so. And then use the bandsaw. Me just a basic shape, and then onto the belt sander to round it all off. Most of the wood off, and now I take it over to the Dremel to do the next stage.
Reminds me of the dentist, unfortunately. There's a filling coming, an expensive filling.
Ow.
That's like a little grind in stone, or is it an actual piece of sanding it's material sand, on the end?
Sandpaper, yeah. It's a little drum of sandpaper on a little rubber disc, isn't
it? It just slides over, does it, then? You know, to load it?
Yeah, that's right. It slides over, and then there's a little screw that just squidges the rubber and holds it in place.
Manual labour.
Yeah, elbow grease.
Any particular grade of paper you use there?
Well, yeah, you obviously start with coarse. And what is this? I don't know.
And then grade it down.
I do use, it's that cloth one. That lasts a lot much better. Don't use the paperback stuff. You want to use the cloth stuff. And you could use a piece of wood, or I just use the hard block of foam there. It moulds nicely. And so the machinery's done the hard work. This is just giving it that final smoothness. So the next stage is marking for the leads, which on my little template I've got where they're going to go. Like that. And then we just give it a little start up.
Now, do they call that a gimlet or a braddle?
Braddle, I call it.
You call it a braddle.
I don't know what else.
I've heard of a gimlet, yeah. I don't know which is which.
That just marks the spot that I need to drill.
So that's to take your wire join and your lead, is it?
That's to take... No, that just takes the main lead.
That's just the weight, the big hole, yeah?
Belly lead. Yeah, I mean, some of them have got a lot of lead in the chin.
Yes.
And only a small balancing lead at the back of the lure. And that'll give you more head-down action. If you were going to... You could put a lot less lead in it, and then it would actually dive as you retrieved it.
Yes.
Almost like a lipped lure, but more subtle.
Yes.
These will sink with a more head-up profile, and then when you retrieve them, they'll rise in the water.
That's so interesting,
these are great for fishing really slow. This is why I'm making them at this time of year, because that's a little pike bait.
Bite-sized,
yeah, good jack pike bait. Sink down, pick it up, wobble it down, pick it up. And by twitching the rod tip, you'll also get it to do dart from side to side. And they love them. So now we sort out the wire. This is stainless steel wire, it's just welding, TIG welding wire. 0.9mm for this size lure, which is fine for general predators, bass, pike, perch. You'll land them all on that. So we just take a length of that and bend in. First of all, we form the nose loop.
No particular haywire twist loop or anything you use there?
No. For these, they're all cemented in when they go into the lure.
So they're sealed, locked in?
Yeah, so they're locked in. So I just
get some twist in there.
Fold it over. Works easier than others.
So a loop at the back, a loop at the front. You push them through and they meet in the middle. Would that be the right way you're looking at it?
No. So that one goes all the way from through ride, right from the front to the back.
Yeah.
And then this is for the belly. What we'd form is a loop with two hooks on either side. Yeah. But the main wire
goes through the ring of that one, yeah.
So what I'm doing there is just measuring the depth. Form that belly loop.
And the epoxy helps seal all this up as well, I imagine, does it? And
between a body filler that seats the leads and this in and the epoxy. Gives you a massively strong seal for it all. And you can see there, that just threads through two loops. It's going to be awkward.
That looks a fiddly job.
Sometimes it goes straight through, and other times it needs some help. There we go. So that's anchored on that wire right through. The only way to get that out would be to break
the wire.
It out.
Yeah. And that's not going to happen because it's sealed in the wood as well.
No, and then it's when it's all sealed in with fuller and epoxy as well. Okay, then the only other thing we haven't done yet is the gills and the mouth parts.
And what do you cut those out with? And
that's done with a Dremel, again with a little disc cutter. On the bigger lures I would drill out an eye socket, but on these little ones you can end up doing too much damage to the face, so I just stick them on the outside.
So next phase will be what, inside?
And then that's it out here. Now we go in, put in the leads and seal it all up with body filler, and then do the foil work over the top of the woodwork. Okay, so this is just Common Garden Car body filler. Mix in the hardener. And that sets in about 5 minutes, so go at it. And first of all, we want to get some around that nose wire. So that's going to anchor that into the nose of the lure. And then thanks to my mate for making these up, little lead weights. You can use lead because they're buried in the body of the lure.
Are they regular size ones or do you have them specially made?
No, they're regular size. I presume they'd be in increments of the old ounces, you know, so you'd have sort of 3/8 of an ounce and 1/4 ounce and 5/8 of an ounce and that sort of thing. But of course, nowadays, you know, if you're making them up for fishing, then they'd use the non-toxic. And these are non-toxic split shot that I just used for the little tiny leads up the front. And that's a modern equivalent of a swan shot going in there. And then and you can see how it squidges up and down the wire, so everything is going to get anchored in. And for anybody that's used this carb body filler, you know how tough it is, and yet it sounds beautifully too. This is probably the fiddliest job. Right, that's all the leads and the holes filled in, and that takes 10 minutes or so to go hard, go on. So whilst it's doing that, I'll show you another type of lure that I make, which is a pencil lure, which is a lure that originated in the US for the striped bass and other sea fish like blues and small tuna bonito, that sort of thing. And again, it's a lipless lure, and you can see it's got a large amount of lead in the rear of it, so it casts like a bullet, and then a small balancing lead up the front. And these again, this is a sinking lure, but as it sinks down tail first. And so when you retrieve it, it can climb. So at a slow retrieve, you can actually pull it through the water. It'll maintain a depth, which means you can count it down, keep it down deep. And as you retrieve and you come near the rocks, the nasty snaggy bits near the shore, you can just speed it up and bring it to the surface. And if you do it quite quick, you can even get it to walk a dog right on the surface itself. So it's a very versatile lure, and one that's completely underutilised in this country.
And they work for pike, do you think?
And they would work for pike, I'm sure. I've not caught a pike on them, but maybe I've got to give it a go this summer. But they're brilliant for bass, pollock, that sort of thing.
So shore fishing as
and
well?
And you can see it. Shore fishing
for
and
casting, because you said it's got a good casting weight. Yeah.
And I use them, you know, mate and I, we use them from the boats, where you can get in under the cliffs, very difficult access otherwise. And you can cast into the rocky shoreline where the bass are feeding and working. And of course, it's a sand eel, isn't it? I mean, it's just...
That's very true, yes, yeah.
You know, bass love sand eels. So, a little word about hooks. Firstly, these days, I tend to use singles. And a free advert for them, but these Gammo SWs, brilliant. Salt water proof, got the little ring on them, so you can just fit them straight on there. And with, you know, the current thing of having to return bass, if you don't already do it voluntarily, singles obviously going to do less damage. Same for pike. I use a lot of singles on my pike lures too.
And they come with a swivel, did they, you say?
These come with a split ring.
Split ring, yeah.
Yeah, for attachment straight on. But I found those are good pattern. As are these, if you want to use a stouter pattern on your saltwater lures. Although these are not as saltwater proof, so you might want to wash them off in fresh water after use. But they're a good stout single fishing on your lures there. The other ones I use are VMCs, good old VMCs. These are 8257s. Which are stouter, so they, you know, they're about a 3x wire, I think.
Oh, triple strength or something
triple
like that.
Triple strength, yeah. So they're good for saltwater lures, but also fine for pike. And then I'm trying to remember. The 726 TAs, I think these are. These are beasts. And these are what go on my GT lures, where you read something that's really going to get stuck in there. And if you ever look at the points on those, they've got like an arrowhead point for really digging into big fish. And you can see the thickness and strength of the wire. Those are fantastic. Owner do a super one as well, but they're a lot more expensive. But that's VMC, cracking hook for real big, tough fish. Now I'm going to put on the aluminium foil, which is, I use that because it gets nice and shiny, but you can mould it around the body of the lure because it's soft metal.
That's a stick-on, self-adhesive then?
Yeah, it's a self-adhesive, just get it from a builder's merchant.
And what do they use that for in the building industry?
They use it for sealing up the panels of insulation that they put in the walls, these big panels of insulation. It seals the crack up between the two. As you see, you can just use the...
It's very pliable by the look of it.
Yeah, it's aluminium, yeah, so it'll just mould around the body. Do one side. The gill and around the mouth part. This gives it a good shine. Then put in the detail so we can put in a lateral line, score that in. And then some scores just sort of indicate scales. On the belly. I'd like to do a different pattern on the top because it then sort of delineates different. So we just
use. And what is that you're putting on there?
That's just a narrowed end of a spanner. And that gives you a load of dents, give you a shimmery scale effect. See that?
Yep, got it, yep.
And same on the other side.
Simple but effective.
Yeah. Yeah. It gives it a good shimmer. And then we'll do the belly scoring.
You've got to be careful not to go right through it, I guess.
Yeah, this is it. Just gently scoring it, scratching it. I'm often going to put in a little extra little bit of detail on the gill there too. Gill cover. There. And there you have the body all ready to paint and make pretty. So now we've got the lure foiled and it's ready for what I call the base coats, which is the underlying colours. And you can see there, there's just a light blue along the back, green highlight there, yellow on the cheek. And by putting these base coats underneath, you can get the depth of colour, and it looks like real fish's skin as opposed to just being a flat effect. Paints are used water-based, these are auto-air colours, and these for the base coats are all transparent colours, so that the foil, the shine of the foil will show up through them. And I use high quality airbrush, it's an Iwata, it's the most expensive bit of kit I own, but a really good airbrush does help. You can use any airbrush to get you started, but a really good quality one, of course, does make it easier, particularly for getting the real detail. This is one that's had its base coat, so what I'll do, because the base coat's a bit boring, but what I'll do is I'll just do a fin on that one, and you can see just how I do that. Right, now we're ready to put a fin on. So you can see I've got a template left and right. I've got hundreds of those. Of course, you can always draw up and cut out new ones for all the different styles. And the way it's done, so you place that on the lure where you want the fin, and then just have a little strip of paper. When you get the coat of epoxy over the top, it'll lift it up and you'll be able to see the colour, and it'll delineate the range.
It makes you stand out more than that.
Makes it stand out more, that's right. Yeah. And then normally what I do is I do a whole series of left-hand side, and then when they're nicely dry, I know that I can come back and do the other side. And then the eyes that I use, I use ready-made eyes. You can make your own with epoxy painting, but these come from the Fishgill Living Eyes from Flymen, American manufacturer. But they're beautiful. They're photographs of a real eye.
Really?
Yeah, that they've then printed onto a foil background with epoxy over the top, and you get these beautiful eyes, four different kinds. And then also you can use sort of standard eyes like that, which are sort of poppers. We get them from all over the place. Some of these from the continent, some from America. And
are they self-adhesive?
Lovely. They're self-adhesive, yeah. So you just stick them on the side and epoxy over the top to seal them in. These ones you can see are countersunk, and some of them I just stick them on the side, you know. I like that because it's a bit frog-like as well.
Bulbous looking, yeah.
To me, that perch pattern, especially over the next month or so, is also a frog pattern, and pike love frogs. Right, then the last process is to get that lovely protective sheen, clear gloss over the top. That's a two-part epoxy that I use. That lure would have three layers of that on. The smaller lures, like these, might only have two layers. Comes in, say, two parts, mix it up, and it cures in about 24 hours, but it goes non-drip after about 5 hours, so that it spreads evenly over the body. You don't get any pooling or runs. I put it on a little homemade spinner here. That's just a slow motor that rotates twice a minute. It's for a disco ball. You get them off the internet. Then made myself up a frame. And as you can see, I angle the lures slightly so that they oscillate as they go round. And that way the epoxy can't settle on any one particular part, and you get this horrible slumping or pooling effect, a big blob of epoxy. And there's nothing to do other than sand it off and start all again. So you can ruin all your work just by having that. But with this little spinner, which you can make up at home yourself, that rotates around. And you need to check it a few times. Just go in there with a brush and just brush off where it may be pooling a bit or just pulling back a little bit off, particularly if you've used some oil-based paints. And the one I use, again, get it off the internet. This one's Envirotex Light. And there's another one, C&W Lure Finish, which is from Sweden.
That's four lures in.
Sorry?
Especially
yeah,
four lures.
That's right. Which is especially for lures as well. And that one is water-based, so it's a bit kinder on the lungs. So we've opened the doors here. So there we are. So you've seen how I make them from start to finish. It should give you a good idea of how it's done. And these are some of the finished ones that I sell. I can make lures of any size and description. As I say, do a lot for pike, a lot for bass from this country. And then a lot of big lures, big poppers and stick baits that go all over the world for fish like GTs and kingfish and tuna of all descriptions. And some of them here, and this is the stick bait, which I've been going on about, that I think more European, British anglers should try, because they work a treat, and you can really work them like a fish and get them into the zone right in front of the nose and almost tease the fish into taking them.
Have you and you've caught bass on those as well, though, yourself?
Yeah. These are good for bass. I catch plenty of bass. I do a lot of fishing myself, needless to say. Here on the south coast of Somerset, out of Lyme, and that's particularly good bass. That pencil, where we drift in our little boat underneath the rocks under the cliffs, cast that into the shore, work it back. And these ones I've actually made for myself, because always making lures for other people, and then I find I haven't got very many for me. So these three I've made myself for if the rivers ever go down after all this rain, get back out there in the milder weather and take them off the top with these little perch patterns. I also do some have some fun with the foiling.
Well, they can see that
a bit more
sure.
Intricate. Yeah, so you can make literally do anything, and they're quite pleasing. This is just on natural wood, but you can obviously do that over.
So that is the grain of the wood there?
That's just the grain of the wood, yeah. These are from a mate of mine up the road, actually. He doesn't know I've made them yet. So he might see it first on TV. For Peter, if you're watching.
YouTube.
Which is off a tree in his garden. So I said I'd make him some lures, so I have done.
So personalising lures is not a problem. You can have your name on it. They can make their own name up of lures. You can have them signed or whatever.
Yep, you can have them any colour, any shape you want. If you've got your own personal design, or you can take one of my designs and have it whatever colour you want. And yeah, and I'll personalise them with your name on them, foil them. It's all doable.
All part of the service.
Yeah, all part of the service. You can get the hooks out of there. There's a nice big stick bait. That's perfect. Similar bait to that, I had a salmon on last year out of the River Tone. About 9 or 10 pound, big cockfish. I was pike fishing at the time. I don't know who was more surprised, me or the salmon. But they also, of course, they're a perfect bass bait, as well as that would do for a small tuna, bonito, that sort of thing as well.
Well, I learned a few good tips there from Jim about making artificial lures. The most important thing I learned was there is in fact a lure, a stick bait, with no vein that I can let flutter down and keep in the kill zone of the predator for that much longer. Got to be a good idea. I for one should be trying that. I hope you enjoy watching it. Keep watching the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. We'll do our best to get you some more fishing tips.